One on. Yeah, much better. And welcome to another grilling edition of the Water and Ukie Cheese Cafe. And before I get onto the episode, first I want to say hit that subscribe button below if you want to get any future updates on new material I'm putting together. And two, here's a public service announcement. If ever you are trying to make some sauerkraut and it ends up going bad, do not try to dispose of it with using a toilet paper bomb. It just leads to a whole bunch of messes that you're not going to want to clean up afterwards. God, what a nightmare. But yeah, that was a previous episode where I was showing you how to teach, where I was teaching how to make sauerkraut. And unfortunately, this is another case of it going bad on me and just ended up going moldy and kind of nasty. So I think I got to figure out what the heck is going on in my house, like why it's doing that. Well, nevertheless, I'm going to drown my sorrows in one of these beers as a final ration before I end the weekend. So, it's an IPA kind of day. I've had some good fun going out into Rosebound, having time with some friends and enjoying some draft beer, but it's a good time to go back to basics, enjoying microbrews at home. And I'm doing another one that's from Trois Mousquetaires in Brossard, one that I've talked about so much in the past. They do have a brand new one that's available here. It's another IPA, but this one, is called the DDH IPA. DDH, that apparently means double dry hop. Any of you people who know these beers better than me can probably explain to me, like, what does dry hop mean? And double dry hop maybe has something to do with the flavor of the hops that you're going to get with this. This one, though, compared to the regular IPA they do, is a little stronger. 6.5 versus the OG 6%. But I've had to give this a good shot. Now, the other IPA I would have too is of the New England IPA sorts as well. So very cloudy, very citrusy taste. So what I'm kind of curious to see is if this is going to be a similar scenario as well. Because they did mention it's going to be fruity as well on the label, along with the double dry hop. And on my immediate inspection and first glance, it looks like it may be a New England sort. The double dry hop is probably going to be the key factor in here for the DDH. Or I guess if you're a wrestling fan, then I'm thinking that the DDH is a poor man's DDT. Just in case you don't know your wrestling moves, a DDT is basically you put some guy head down in a headlock and then you just drive his head into the ground. Back in the old days, that used to be a finishing move. Like, if you're going to get it, you knew you were going to be out for the count. Now just a transition move, because people are... Wait, that doesn't have anything to do with this, does it? Yeah, forget about DDTs, let's just go to DDH. Yep, citrusy, still cloudy tasting, whatever clouds taste like. I guess you could just kick one of the clouds up in the sky and you get an idea of it. But it does have a slightly hoppier taste than the other one too. So I guess that's the double dry hop. Makes the hops even a bit more pronounced. Quite groovy, quite satisfying, and quite happy indeed. And with this kind of heat and possibly humidity, I'm glad that I have a bit of shade right now. But nevertheless, because of the heat especially, it gives me good incentive to want to get some grilling done for myself. Now, if you've been following my channel for quite some time, I think you're more than aware that I love my steak, but I especially love my bavette. Or, as I call it in English, beef flat meat. I don't know, flat meat doesn't seem like it has the same kind of a pizzazz as bavette. Bavette gives it like a sense of class, I suppose, right? And I've probably mentioned a lot of times in past episodes how I do this and put it together, but I figure that I haven't done a little grilling exercise in quite some time, and I kind of want to do this again, like a little recap. This time with current production values, because my videos have come a long way. Oops, forgot a prop. Be right back. Okay, we're back. Man, sometimes I gotta organize my stuff a bit properly. So, my favorite way to do steak really depends on the cut that I'm gonna be getting. So if I'm going to be getting myself a T-bone, and I'm going to get myself a contre-filet or even a faux filet steak, there's a pretty good chance I'm going to be doing a dry rub for that. But what I would do for that is a Montreal steak spice seasoning. My suggestion is, if you want to have a really good one, make it yourself. It's very economical, you make it with all sorts of stuff that's already on your spice rack, and you get it in very huge quantities. But the key is that with a lot of the spices that you're going to get in the store-bought brands, there's a pretty good chance that there's going to be a lot of salt in there, because it's a cheap filler material, and it's like, if you want to put a bit extra, you just put some salt. And you'd be able to tell by the consistency and the color, because most of the time in the bottle, you'll notice there's a lot of white in there. But when you make it your own like this, you're not going to notice too much white. It's going to be a bit more of like your blend of paprika, maybe chili, and dry mustard, which gives it this orangey taste. You're not going to notice that much white in there. That's really the key. But what I like to do for when it comes to bavette is a marinade. And hat tip to Canadian Dave in the comments section, because he's the one that introduced me to this. So what you're going to want to do for this is you just want to get your Dijon mustard out, and you want to take like maybe 1 tablespoon worth of it, maybe a heaping tablespoon, so that you have a little bit of extra you can work with on here. It really all depends on how much you're working with. One steak, this is going to be fine, but if you're doing 2 or maybe more, you might want to double up your recipes. And then what you would do is you take 1 tablespoon of olive oil. Alright. So just something like that. What this is going to do is it's going to help lubricate it and let it all bond and stick together. And that's all you're really going to need to do for your steaks. But I kind of altered my recipe so that now what I do is I include like 1 tablespoon of Worcestershire sauce, or slightly less than that. I've been finding that whenever I do cooking with beef, this actually gives a really, really good flavor. So I'm just going to take that, add it in here, and the good thing is that you don't really have to mix it too hardcore, because it's all going to get mixed in the end. Next, I'm going to be taking 1 plastic glove, because I want to minimize how much I'm washing my hands in this thing. Before I do that, got to get some fuel in. Once you have all your ingredients in here, open up your pack of steak, and then you can throw it in to your bag. And then you want to make sure you minimize contact with the bag as much as possible so that you're not going to be infecting everything. There. So that's in here. And you want to make sure you squeeze out all of the air from the bag before you seal it up. There we are. And here's a little trick whenever you're working with these kind of gloves or any kind of disposable gloves. You don't want to affect anything. Take it off inside out. Then you have nothing to worry about. And then once you have all your stuff in here and you have your clean hands, just give this thing a bit of a massage so that you could actually work the beef into the marinade, but also to blend all the ingredients together in the marinade. There we go. And that's all you really need to do for your prep work for the steak. So what you're going to want to do then is you're going to want to throw it in the fridge so it cools off a bit when it's blending in. In terms of prep time, I would say that you would need minimum 1 hour just to get it done properly. You could probably do it even longer than that, because rule of thumb is that whenever you marinate something, the longer the meat sits in it, the more flavorful it's going to become. Because I don't have too much time to work with, I'm just going to do it like that. 1 hour plus is going to be fine. You're still going to get plenty of taste. So we'll get that into the fridge. I'm going to enjoy this. And then when we come back, I'm going to set up my rig over here. And I guess I could use this as an example of how I set up my rig too. Because I think the last time I did that was my very second episode of the Cheese Cafe when I did burgers. But I haven't shown you from A to Z how to do this as well. Because charcoal? Well, I guess we'll get to the explanation afterwards. We shall return after these messages. After these messages? Dude, I don't have a sponsor. How can I give messages? Well, now it's time to get some of the grilling done now that I got my brew out of the way. So, any of you who's been watching this channel for a little while and knows that the setup is weird, well, I changed a few things around because I'm experimenting with a future deck project for to come later on, if all goes well. But just to reiterate, in case you're jumping onto the channel, this is what I like to use over here. It's the Kamado A. Got this one like about a good 4 years ago, and the downside is that this thing is no longer available, at least not this way. It's made of reinforced steel, and nowadays the only ones you can really find are the ones that are made out of ceramic. Those are good too. Main issue with that is that they come at a high price. This cost like maybe a couple $100. Ceramic ones, if you love to get for $800 to $900. Some places would charge like maybe around $1,200 for that, so bear with that if you really want to use this one. And the great thing that I like about it is just because of the depth. They call it the Kamado egg just because if you're to look at the shape of this thing, this is shaped like an egg, but just in reverse. And it's pretty deep over here, so you're actually able to do some indirect cooking in addition to direct cooking, and also even smoke too, if you know what you're doing with this stuff. Now, what do you mean by direct cooking or indirect? Well, it's a pretty simple basic thing. So, direct heat cooking basically means that you have the fire right below here with the grill on top, and then you're just cooking it with the flames. But if you're using what's called indirect heat, it means that you have something to kind of block off the source of the smoke, source of the heat, and the source of the fire when it's cooking here. So one of the things, I don't really use this much because I don't have the right size, but most of these grills are going to come with one of these plates that you put, and it's going to be fitting like right around the middle, So what you do is you can put a big piece of ceramic or a big piece, it's actually going to be like a piece of stone that's called a heat deflector. So what that does is that it's going to block the fire. It's going to heat this thing up. So you're going to be getting the heat from here without having the fire cooking directly on the stuff above. So it's a good way to get things slower cooked and also not to expose it to the fire, so it's going to char quicker. Of course, this one didn't come with it, but if you do go for one of those ceramic Kamado wades, they do tend to come with the heat deflector. So that, I guess that is one benefit. And if you're going to be grilling with this thing, here's a first a couple of steps. So step one, open up the barbecue, and then this one comes with one of these hooks to remove the grill. Keep that aside. There's a bit of gunk on here, but I'm not going to worry about it because I do have a purpose for this stuff too, and we'll get to that in a second. Then what you're going to need to do, lost my sandal. So what you're going to need to do then is fill this up with about 2 pounds of the charcoal briquettes. If you're going for those square ones in the store, I would suggest avoid them and go for what I like to use, these hardwood lump charcoal. It's basically pieces of wood treated with the carbon to give it a better burn. Because those square ones are really difficult to light, and the only way you're really going to get it done properly is if you're using lighter fluid. And I tend to avoid that stuff. You're going to probably want like a good 2 pounds worth of charcoal in here, give or take. So you dump it in here. And if you're a real stickler for getting this done properly, then you could take whatever you dumped in here, take your spatula, and then just make it more like a pyramid scheme. Not pyramid scheme. You're not trying to rip people off the money with this thing. So you want to have this as a bit of a pyramid. Make it more towards the center here so it's going to be easier for it to light up and to char up. Once you have this set up into your liking, it will be time to consider your ignition elements. There's going to be a lot of them you're finding in most stores that are going to work to varying degrees, like made of wax. My favorite ones are the ones that are made out of a combination of sawdust and wax that are bound together so that it's able to light up properly. But I haven't been able to find them as much. So what I've been using lately are these things. Fire stars that say they have powered energy granules. I have no clue what the heck that's supposed to mean. I've had some ups and downs with this stuff, but I think I found the perfect way to get these to work for me. It takes me like maybe a good 2, maybe 3 of them to do. Now what I like to do is I like to put them in a little triangular pattern all spread out over here so that you cover every single corner of this. From my other experiences with this, doing it this way didn't always light it up properly for me because it would actually light up each of those corners but not spread around. So what I've actually done to correct this is I had another material that I decided to use. Regular kindling wood. I bought these a while back when I used to have an actual fire pit here. Because they're banned now and mine kind of went to the shit, haven't really had a use for it. So with this, you can actually just lay these down. And what that's going to do is it's going to help get the flames going even stronger. You don't have to worry about what kind of a element or what kind of a setup you do for that. Just as long as it's there and the flame is going to spread. One other element that you're going to need to remember too is before you do set up your flames, you're going to have a vent on the bottom of this thing that you should open up completely. That is going to allow airflow to get in, because what happens is once this thing is closed up, well, I guess I'll explain in a second then when I actually do get to that step, but you open this up for airflow. Then once you got that done, you can ignite this. I guess the one benefit to this is that you don't have to work too hard with these energy capsules. You just have to light it and then it ignites automatically. So you just have to let this burn until the fire is ready to go out. Eventually it's going to spread to the wood. And then once you see it starting to peter out after about a good 10 to 15, 13 minutes, you could close this thing. So again, you'd let that burn for maybe about a good 10 minutes before you do close this thing, and then we'll get to the other steps to explain the whole open vent afterwards. All I know is that if it's this sunny and if it's going to be grilling season, there's no way I can't be having a beer to go along with that too. Now that my IP is out of the way. So I have my glass here. And if you're wondering what's the next one going to be, I feel like going ghetto today. I've had my share of fancy stuff, so I'm going to go for one jumbo fucker. Jumbo fucker is my category for 740 or 710 milliliter cans. It's like only a select few of these kinds of beers are going to be in such giant formats. And then if it goes in a 1 liter bottle, which is even fewer, then I like to call that the supreme fucker. Why this one? Let's see, something from Missouri, but it's only 4.7%. And I kind of want to have something light and easy to go with the grilling activities. I've had this one numerous times, and I think this would be something that my dad would have enjoyed too. Like, this would be his style of beer. Basic, simple, standard issue. Like, not like the fancy stuff that I've been drinking in this day and age, which probably back then in the 70s, 80s, 90s would not have even existed. So, what a beautiful thing. So I'm just gonna enjoy this thing now. Then once I see the flames are gonna be petering out, then I'll know it's time to close up shop. Not close up shop, close up the grill. Close up the grill. We're not done today, people. So one of my three flames is gonna be out, so that's a pretty good sign. I'm gonna be taking this and closing it. And then next step is gonna be a little vent at the top that goes from levels 0 to 5. Open up completely to 5. So what that's gonna do is allow the fire to build up inside of here. What this is gonna do is, it's very similar to venting a computer or even venting a soffit, an attic in the house. It's gonna be venting at the hot air from the top of this and then pulling the air from the outside from the bottom of the vent that's opening up, and that's gonna help you build up your flame properly. So for most cuts of your meat too, you wanna make sure this thing goes to about 350 degrees minimum. And you can tell it's going to be 350 degrees because mine actually comes equipped with a thermometer, so I can see this thing moving around and then playing it by ear. And then once that's done, once it's at 350, I can add the grill onto that, let that heat up a bit, and then I'm going to clean it off. I'll clean it off afterwards because I have a really good reason for it. But all this to say that charcoal, it's a really good flavor, good taste, a lot of people love it. But the caveat is that it does take a lot of time and effort to get properly. At least I know with the propane grill, you just have to open up the gas and then it's much easier to work with instead of being a full production. This one is probably good if you're doing like a full barbecue with family or you're doing your whole meal on this or multiple courses. But if you're going to be doing like just a steak in 10 minutes, I know that propane's probably the easiest thing to use. So let's let this thing heat up. And then we're gonna get to the next steps after. So this thing is now at 350 degrees. It's the perfect time to put your grill in. So just take your hook with the grill and then shove it on in here. And then that you're gonna let this thing heat up until it feels like that the grease on there is gonna be easy enough to maneuver around. Just in case you wanna know what else you need to see about your charcoal, you want to look through the top and then see if you're going to get any glowing embers in there too, in addition to seeing any kind of layer of gray soot right on top of your charcoal. That's your surefire sign that you have enough heat and that it's going to be prepared for cooking. But so while we're letting this thing fix up, I'm going to be doing something else I enjoy doing. One eggplant. I got hooked on this recently and I kind of enjoy doing this on the grill very basically too. So what you're going to do on this, you're just going to cut off a slicing knife to end of each. Just like that. You might have a leaf that hangs on the side of here, but don't worry about it. And do the same thing on this side. You can compost this stuff, but if you're like me and you have a yard, well, you probably know what's coming up if you've been following my channel. Yeah. Just throw it in the yard, and then it's going to compost and it mixes with the soil. And there's this little leaf. There. So all you want to do with this is you want to slice it in half inch slices or 3/4 inch slices, depending on your preference. And then once you're done with all of that, keep it aside. And then once the fire and the grill are all set to go, you can add this onto the fire. I didn't really like eggplant much when I was growing up as a kid. In fact, I don't think I've even had it when I was young. My first exposure to this was oddly enough in Concordia when I was going to university. Discovered a sandwich place over there that was called Sant'Angelo's, which sadly closed down. Yeah, because when you're a university student looking for a cheap meal, that was one of the good spots too. So what they had done was their signature sandwiches was a veal parmesan sandwich. And if you wanted it all dressed, you would probably get it with hot peppers, provolone cheese, eggplant, and some other stuff in there too. I didn't mind the eggplant in fact, mostly because it was marinated, cut small, and plus because you also have a strong provolone cheese too. When it's all blended together with veal parmesan, the sauce and everything, you're not even going to notice the little intricacies. I tried it on my own years later, didn't like it because the texture is not for everyone. But when you prepare this thing properly, it's amazing to do. But it's also pretty basic, because, relatively speaking. You don't have to go too fancy with this stuff. So how are we doing here? It's still at 350 degrees, we're perfect. So let's give this a few more minutes. Still at 350 degrees. So what you want to do then is work to scrape off all the grease on your grill. Most of the time what you're going to see are those bristle brushes that are found in every single store. And I tend to prefer these wooden ones that have these ridges at the bottom of it so that you're able to scrape off your grill properly. It's also because I've read enough reports about how the bristles get in the break off of those brushes, and if you ingest one, it's kind of deadly, and I'd rather not take the risk. So once you're working this up, you just have to scrape off whatever residue is left out here. The reason you want to do this while you're grilling is a very simple reason. Any leftover char or residue that's on these grills are going to fall into the charcoal at the bottom, and it's actually going to help ignite the heat just a little bit more. In fact, you might actually set it on fire too, depending on what's left over. If you're using something that has like a very heavy grease or marinade, like with something a lot of oil, it may actually set it on fire once again. And I know I've had some experiences with that too. Okay, it's probably hard to see on camera now, but I'm looking at my grill and I'm seeing embers, I'm seeing a good layer of gray soot on top of all of my charred hardwood charcoal. That tells me that this thing, if I give it a few more minutes, is gonna be ready for grilling. So before we get to that steak, we are going to do all of the steak lines. That should be all of it. Get this center part done. There we go. So you got most of your work done to grill with charcoal. Of course, if you don't want this thing to stick, you could take that grill off. Maybe you spray some Pam, or you could even apply some oil onto it too, because then that way your stuff is not going to stick to it, and then you won't have to worry about struggling with your food. You know, the usual stuff. Here. So what I'm going to do with this is I'm just going to oil up my eggplant, throw it onto the grill, let it cook. So to do that, what I'm going to be using is some avocado oil. Olive oil is like a really good one that's well-rounded that you can apply to anything. It's still going to be tasty. But the beauty of avocado oil is that it's going to be a high heat temperature of 260 degrees. Yeah, apparently some of these are going to be have a certain threshold of cooking. Some react better to cooking at higher temperatures than others. So I'll just use this one. And, oh yeah, circling back to that, it does have a bit of a sweeter flavor that works really well with vegetables. It was a buddy of mine that introduced me to that. So we'll take this off. I'm going to take each slice. Use my silicone brush to apply a good amount and apply it to the grill. And then you keep repeating that for all of your slices. And then whenever you're ready, you just take the same amount of oil that's in the container and then you apply it to the other side as it's cooking. Oil is all applied. I'm going to close this, let it sit for about a good couple of minutes. Then afterwards, I'll open it up. Apply the next layer of oil, and then flip this around. It's only been about 3 minutes, but it should be enough. Let's open this up, and then we're gonna apply the rest of the oil to all the slices. There, just it on like that. You don't have to worry about stinging on this stuff. Just be extra liberal if you want. Huh. I'm having trouble speaking today. It must be the heat. There we go. I think I've got most of them covered. A little bit left here. One here. So now that that's done, just take metal tongs, and then you can flip it around. And you'll know you're doing this properly too, because you're going to get some grill marks on these. If not, well, it could be a case of the heat is not as strong on that side, but you can always play around with it. Basically, if you notice that the heat is strong on one side but not on the other, switch these around to give it a good distribution. Just like that. Almost there, and there you go. Then you cover that up, and then you just let it sit for another couple of minutes. You might have some oil left, like I said, but don't be afraid to use that up if ever you need. You can either apply it again to your slices of eggplant, or worst case, when you're done with that and you're ready to grill your steak, just take a little bit of that, dab it onto the grill itself before you put the meat on it, then that should help it not stick at all. It's gonna be hard because there's already oil in that marinade, but you know, just to be safe, you can always do that as well. Shouldn't take much longer, and then we'll put our steak on very soon. The steak should really only take you like maybe a good like 10-15 minutes maybe. That really depends on your preference for if you like it rare, medium rare, or well done. It's up to you. The beauty of bavette is that no matter how overcooked it is, it's still going to be a juicy tender one and you're still going to enjoy it. I've had people tell me that they've had so many steaks overcooked to the point that they weren't able to have it on its own, that they needed ketchup to give it to make it easier. It's all a matter of preference. Some people like it. Some people don't. Some people say that to do a steak properly, if it's done right, you don't even need ketchup to begin with. We'll see how it goes. I've never been disappointed with a bavette before. You pay a little bit more, but good quality stuff. Have another look at this. Yep. Maybe I can just apply a little bit more oil to some of the spots that were missed before, and then that would give me some nice char lines that I think I might have neglected. There we go. And I'll make sure I have enough for my steak as I had planned originally too. Luckily the steak's gonna take so little space that I don't even have to worry about having too much left over. Just have enough that I can slide it around. There we are. Ah yes, second round had some pretty good char marks, so that tells me it's doing its job. In terms of cooking time, you basically just want to make sure that this is softened enough when you're working with it. And again, you really only need just oil and then you're fine. If you really want to have some extra flavoring with this, then you could always go for, I suppose, sprinkling some coarse salt on this too. Because salt is one of those things that when you put on a vegetable, mwah, it's a beauty thing. It's about as good as it's going to get, so yeah. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to remove it and put it onto my cutting board. Keep this aside until I'm ready to serve and put this away. So now it's going to be time to take care of the steak. Almost there. Just a few small pieces. There. So what you want to do next is take whatever remaining oil is in here. And then you can just sprinkle it mostly on the surface that you're going to be grilling your meat on. Just don't be scared, because there is going to be some flames potentially building up at the bottom, but it's going to be minor. Just do that. Then you're going to take your hunk of meat, grab it, and obviously choose a spot. I'm choosing here because this looks like it's going to be the best charred thing. So put it on. Close it, and then you can do like 5 to 7 minutes on each side. So after 5 to 7 minutes, you flip it around, let it get some good char marks, and then you determine how much more cooked you want it to be. So I'll let that sit, dump this, and wash my hands. Ugh. Oh boy, raw cow. It's a lovely thing. It hasn't been exactly 6 minutes or 7 minutes yet, but I'm gonna flip it because I'm noticing my thermostat's going above 400 degrees. So I'll open it up. So another trick to remember too with your meats is that you want to make sure that, yeah, it's going to be charred on the bottom, but you also want to make sure it's like slightly browned at the top too, to give you an indication it's starting to cook properly. Use the same logic if you're using burgers, because if you don't get patient with that and wait till it browns on the top, it is going to fall apart. So I'll take my tongs, flip it, and then you'll notice that there are some char marks that are starting to build up over here. I'm actually going to move it here because I'm noticing the heat is actually stronger on this side than on here. And then what I'm doing now is I'm just taking these, applying them to the grill directly, and that should kill any of the germs. This is actually something I picked up from a few friends when I was hanging out with them at a Korean barbecue. You use that for your meats to put it in, but just put it onto fire and heat, if that should kill it and disinfect it. Fire kills everything. Well, fire's good for a lot of things. And we're not going to get into all those applications. There we go. Oh. Somehow this thing is still up to 400 degrees. I don't know how the heat's getting to it. So let's have a look. Oh yeah. So I'm going to give it another flipping and yep, looking it's like it's pretty good. So most of the time you want to make sure it looks like this. So that all your juices are going to be charred. Ah, damn motorcycles. You want to make sure that your juices are going to be flowing out. The outside is charred. And then, of course, like again, you want to play to your taste. If you want to do this medium rare, well done, rare, or somewhere within all the extremes. So in my case, I'm just going to be giving this a few more minutes to really char up. Then I'm going to whip up some other stuff inside, serve myself a little bit of an eggplant as well, and enjoy a meal. I'm not going to do a taste test with this like usual, because you've seen me do Babette countless times, you already know what it's like. We don't need to revisit that again. But I hope that with this latest episode, that you got a good idea of how to do barbecuing with a charcoal grill. So thanks for watching this edition of the Warren and Ukie Cheese Cafe. Of course, I haven't forgotten about that. If you like what you see, just hit that subscribe button below and give this video a thumbs up if you enjoy my antics. And leave me a comment if you have any suggestions for future episodes, future recipes, a microbrew to try, perhaps a random neighborhood I should visit one day that should be documented. By all means, let me know. And of course, it's going to be bad jokes like galore, because I'm a cheese factory. It's a fact of life. Peace, everyone, and enjoy the rest of your weekend.